Have you ever wondered about Game Boy memory addresses? Doesn't matter. What am I even talking about? You see, the Game Boy is a computer. And like other computers, it has memory that it can read from and write to. Things like program code, graphics data, and player health. Let's have a look at some Game Boy memory. This is a Game Boy's video RAM, or VRAM. It's where the stuff the Game Boy uses to render graphics is stored. It has the tile maps and tile data. This is the work RAM, or WRAM. That's the general purpose memory that games would use to temporarily store useful information. For example, a game might store a player's HP in work RAM. There's memory in the cartridge, too. This is the game's read-only memory, or ROM. It has all the game's code, graphics data, and music. It's important! This is the cartridge RAM. It's usually used to store game progress, so it's also called save RAM, or SRAM. When you're playing a game where you can save, this is where that save data is stored. It's usually connected to a little battery, so if you have old cartridges with precious saves on them, you might want to consider backing them up, and you might consider replacing the battery. Okay, so we have four different bits of memory, but that's not how the Game Boy treats it. If you were writing a game for the Game Boy, you don't have to deal with four different types of memory. It's all just mushed together as one big piece of memory with different parts that do different things. This is called memory mapping. That's where a computer pretends that a bunch of different hardware are all just part of the same memory. When you're programming for the Game Boy, you use the same kind of instructions to read and write data from the cartridge as you would to read and write data from video RAM. You just use different memory addresses to say where you want to get data from or put data to. A memory address is just a number that refers to a particular memory location. The Game Boy's memory addresses are 16-bit numbers, meaning they're between 0 and 65,535. You can write the address in binary to see all 16 bits. The rightmost bit is address bit 0, or A0. It's the lowest bit of the address, also called the least significant bit. The leftmost bit is address bit 15, or A15. It's the highest bit, also called the most significant bit. The rest of the bits from right to left are A1 to A14. This numbering is useful, because it gives us a way of talking about individual bits in the address. This is a memory chip. There's a reason why I'm showing it to you, so bear with me. It's like the ROM chip inside a game cartridge, just bigger, and you can change what's on it. These metal pokey bits are the chip's pins. Some of those pins are address pins. Each of those pins is used for one bit of the address. Chips don't really use numbers and bits directly, though. They use electrical signals to represent bits. The Game Boy and this chip use what's called 5-volt logic. If you want to set an address bit to 0, you connect the corresponding address pin to 0 volts, or ground. If you want an address bit to be 1, you connect the corresponding address pin to 5 volts. If you want to access a particular address, you need to connect all the address pins up to the voltages corresponding to the bits of the address. Then the chip can output the data at that memory location. Changing the connections changes the address and changes what part of the memory is being accessed. The Game Boy CPU has 16 connections going out of it that go into the cartridge connector, and the cartridge connects them to the ROM chip. This is called the address bus. When the CPU sees an instruction to load data from ROM, it sends the appropriate electrical signal onto the address bus. There's also a data bus that connects the CPU to the data pins on the memory chip. That's so the CPU can get data from or send data to the chip. But we already saw that the Game Boy is connected to more than one memory chip, and they're all accessed using different addresses in the same 16-bit address range, using memory mapping. The memory chips don't know about the memory map, though. For example, the work RAM is mapped to addresses between 49,152 and 57,343. But the work RAM chip is just expecting an address between 0 and 8,191. It's up to the Game Boy to figure out which chip an address is meant for and convert the address to something the target chip understands. This is easy to convert. If you look at 49,152 and 57,343 as binary, you can see these bits don't change. They'll be the same for all the work RAM addresses. If we just ignore them, then the work RAM range turns into 0 to 8,191, which is the range that the work RAM chip wants. So we can connect A0 to A12 from the address bus to a RAM chip and call it work RAM. We'll also connect the data pins from the work RAM chip to the data bus. This causes a problem though, because now the ROM chip and the work RAM chip will respond to the same addresses. They'll both try to send signals to the data bus. That's a problem called bus contention. So the Game Boy also needs to pick which chip it wants to talk to, and somehow tell that chip that it's the one that should respond. So there are two things happening when the CPU executes code to read from or write to a memory address. It needs to figure out where the address is meant for, and it needs to convert the address. Nintendo could have made that logic as complicated as they wanted, but they were motivated to keep it as simple as possible, because simple tends to be cheaper. You can use the patterns in the memory map addresses to make a guess about how Nintendo designed it. This is the Game Boy's full memory map. It has the cartridge ROM. The ROM gets half of all the addresses, which makes sense since it's so important. Next is video RAM, then the save RAM, work RAM, something called mirror or echo RAM, then the object attribute memory or OAM, that's the memory that controls sprite graphics on the Game Boy. Then a forbidden section, which is strange. Then the I.O. registers, those are special memory addresses that affect parts of the Game Boy's hardware, like checking the button presses and turning the screen on and off. Then HRAM, which is like work RAM but faster. And finally, the interrupt enable register, which is outside the I.O. register section for some reason. The first thing to notice is that each section in the memory map are such that if you ignore some of the higher address bits, then they all look like they start from zero. Well, except for the interrupt enable register, but that's just one address. And except for the forbidden section. It's forbidden though, so maybe it'll be fine. This pattern makes it really easy to do conversion. No fancy subtraction, you just ignore bits. Now we need to figure out how the Game Boy decides which chip it wants to talk to. The OAM, forbidden section, I.O. registers, HRAM, and interrupt enable register are special. They all live inside the CPU chip. It's easy to detect if an address is meant for inside the CPU, because all those addresses have A15 through A9 equal to 1. If those are all 1s, the Game Boy knows to look in the CPU. So let's look at the OAM. We can see that the OAM addresses have A8 equal to 0, but not all addresses with A8 equal to 0 are meant for the OAM. But look at the last address in the OAM range. It's weird. We'd have to check a bunch of bits to know if an address is outside of that range. That sounds expensive. You know what's cheaper? Just saying that all the rest of those addresses are forbidden. And that's what Nintendo did. The I.O. registers all have A8 equal to 1 and A7 equal to 0. Once the Game Boy knows an address is meant for the I.O. registers, it just needs to look at A6 through A0 to know which one. The rest of the memory in the CPU is HRAM, except for the very last address, which has all its address bits equal to 1. That address is used to control hardware interrupts. That's an important feature of the Game Boy, and probably why it has that special address. Now we can hop back out of the CPU. We're left with the ROM and various RAMs. The video RAM is a bit special though. If you've ever played a Game Boy, you may have noticed it has a display. The Game Boy needs to control that display to show graphics. In order to do that, it needs to access the video RAM. The curious thing is that the Game Boy can actually be running game code while it's also changing the display. There is a restriction though. That code can't read from or write to video RAM. It's locked because it's needed to control the display. It can access the ROM, save RAM, work RAM, and mirror RAM no problem though. So we can guess that the video RAM doesn't use the same bus that the ROM, save RAM, work RAM, and mirror RAM use. In fact, it doesn't. The video RAM is connected to what I'll call the video bus, and the ROM, save RAM, work RAM, and mirror RAM are connected to what I'll call the main bus. Looking at the memory map, we can see that if an address has A15 equal to 1, and A14 and A13 equal to 0, then the CPU should send the rest of the bits to the video bus. Otherwise, if it's not an address meant for inside the CPU, then it sends the address signals to the main bus. Now we have a bunch of things all on the main bus, all getting the same addresses. We just need to tell them apart. The ROM is easy. All addresses meant for the ROM have A15 equal to 0. Now we just need to distinguish between an address meant for the save RAM, work RAM, and mirror RAM. I'll start with the mirror RAM thing. What is it? It acts like a copy of work RAM, but missing the last 512 bytes. That's weird, but it probably comes down to keeping things simple and cheap. Nintendo could have added another memory chip for more work RAM, but that would have made the Game Boy more expensive. Since they didn't, we're left with another unused chunk of memory addresses. Looking at the addresses, we can see that A15 and A14 are both 1 for the work RAM and mirror RAM. A13 could be used to tell if an address is meant for the real work RAM, or if it's meant for the mirror RAM. But why bother? We can just ignore A13, and it would look like there are two copies of work RAM. One where A13 is 0, and one where it's 1. Now we can use A14 to tell the difference between work RAM and save RAM. That gives us enough information to tell what type of memory any address is meant for, and how to convert them. I've definitely glossed over a bunch of details, but I think it's fun to look at a piece of technology and try to imagine how it works and how it might have been designed. Thanks for watching. Bye!